Founded on October 4th, 1985, the FSF, or the Free Software Foundation, recently had its 40th anniversary. And whilst out of the limelight today, the FSF and the attached organizations are responsible for a lot of the things that make the FOSS world what it is. Things like the GPL licenses in use nowadays. We commonly have GPL V2, GPL V3, the AGPL versions, and the All Leader variants. The GNU toolset, which whilst there are other tool sets like UUtils, for example, the GNU Core UTils toolset is still the main thing we use on Linux. GCC, Bash, and a lot of other tools come from the FSF, come from FSF sponsoring, and really wouldn't exist today without that having had happened. Now, some of these tools may have left the foundation, may be managed by other people, but it cannot be understated how foundational this organization was to the creation of the FOSS world we know today. Now, I know I'm a little bit late, probably about 2 weeks by the time this is being uploaded, but alongside the anniversary, they also released a blog post. FSF turns 40 with a groundbreaking new project and a new president. This part is less exciting. This second paragraph is just explaining how there are some volunteers who are doing things in the FOSS world and all that good stuff. Let's skip ahead to the next one because this has the announcement of the groundbreaking new project. In the afternoon, FSF Executive Director Zoe Kuman announced an exciting new project. Librephone. Librephone is a new initiative by the FSF to bring full computing freedom to mobile computing environments. The Librephone project is a partnership with Rob Savoy, a developer who's worked on free software including the GNU toolchain since the 1980s. Since mobile phone computing is now so ubiquitous, we're very excited about Librephone and think it has the potential to bring software freedom to many more users all over the world. This is the groundbreaking new project. A free software phone. This is not groundbreaking. This is at least from what has been made public, maybe there's something behind closed doors that hasn't been said yet, but a free software phone is a well-trodden path. It is a project that has been attempted a number of times with varying levels of success, but the idea of a free software phone is definitely not a new one. In fact, there are devices you can buy right now that are free software phones. Most notably is the Librem 5 from Purism and the PinePhone from Pine64. Now, there is obviously some argument to be made about how much of it is free software, and this is where you start getting into the oddities of phones. And we'll talk more about this, but when it comes to the PinePhone, they went so far as chasing the FSF's RYF certification. This is the Respect Your Freedom certification, which basically says that everything on the device is freedom-respecting software. With the exception of the blobs in ROM, we don't talk about those blobs. Those blobs are not important. But anything that is run on the CPU, anything that is loaded from a drive, that is going to be free software. Even at the detriment of the usability of the device. And this is why there's a big mess with that certification. The certification works mostly fine when we're talking about desktop computers, laptops, and simple computing devices like a router, for example. But when we are talking about a phone, you end up creating this situation where you have to design the phone in a really weird, unoptimal way, or kind of just accept the fact that reality exists and you cannot actually do anything about it. Both of these devices have some serious problems. The Librem 5, well, it's kind of very expensive. That's honestly its main problem, and there's not really much that you can do about that. Now, $800 might not sound crazy for a phone until you start looking at the specs it has, and then you're like, ah, this is a phone from 2012. Yeah, this is going to be a big problem with any device made in this space. The other option with the PinePhone is you make a device that is considerably cheaper, but it also ends up being a really underpowered device. This is only $200, but it really doesn't even feel like a $200 phone. It feels like a $200 phone again from 2015, 2016, at the latest, maybe even older. And I want to be very clear, this is not a problem with either of these devices inherently, whether it be the Librem 5, whether it be the Pine phone, whether it be a bunch of the other phones that exist in a similar sort of manner. If you want to build a repairable free software phone, you are extremely limited in what you can do. Unless you want to spend hundreds of millions in R&D, you're basically at the whims of what the part manufacturers allow you to do. Are you allowed to post schematics? Are you allowed to sell parts? Are you allowed to have a modem that is powered by a free software driver? The modem is the hardest part. Dealing with anything involving radio, that immediately makes every problem 100 times harder. And when it comes to the modem, there are some free software options, but they're often not very good. They're very power inefficient, and they're not really great to use in a portable device like a phone. But you can't really just go and make something better, because really you're at the whims of the carriers. If the carriers don't allow what you make on the network, you don't get to be on the phone network. A prime example of this is Vodafone, specifically in Australia. There is a list of whitelisted devices. Anything that is not on this list, is it gonna work? Who knows? Probably not. Good luck. Have fun with that one. Actually, Australia is a whole mess of a problem besides this. There are 5G devices that don't work on our network that support every band that is supported because they do some random little things in the background with 3G but don't tell you about it, and Australia doesn't have a 3G network anymore, so yeah. But this is just Australia, and it's not just Australia. Anywhere you go is gonna have requirements for what devices are allowed to be on their network, and it's not as easy as just writing a free software version and you be done with it. It needs to be certified by them, it needs to be allowed on their network, and that's a whole big mess. And none of this is to say that, you know, somebody couldn't work something out and create something that's gonna work really well, but that's kind of the state of things right now. And right now, basically your best option is, well, run a modified version of Android, run a version of Android that isn't packed with all of the stuff that comes directly from your phone manufacturer, and if you don't want to do that, there is some other alternative. There is a project known as Halium, the hardware abstraction layer for GNU Linux under Android. Halium is an open source project which bridges the gap between Android hardware layer abstractions, HAL, and Ubuntu Touch. It's used with other things as well, but this is on the Ubuntu Touch website, or the UVPorts website. It leverages Librehybris, which allows the system to use Android hardware drivers, making it possible to use hardware like cameras and sensors. Librehybris, in effect, translates Android-specific drivers to non-Android Linux kernels, basically allowing Linux distros that are using Linux kernels to run Android drivers that would normally run on an Android kernel. Now, obviously, the Android kernel is built off of the Linux kernel, but it is its own separate thing. There's a bunch of additional patches, a bunch of additional drivers, and all this fun stuff that isn't available in upstream, so things don't just magically work. This is the thing that makes it magically work. Now, I do want to be clear that Halium is not the only project doing this. There are projects that are forked off of Halium that are using a similar model to Halium and basically achieving effectively the same goal. Some of these things use Halium, some use Halium and also have their own thing. But either way, when you're making use of what comes from Android, it leads to a much wider range of support. Now, 26 devices isn't that many devices, but these aren't 15-year-old phones. Some of these are still reasonable phones to use, like a Fairphone. this is a totally reasonable phone. A Pixel 3a is not the newest phone out there, but it's still a totally viable phone. Same thing will go over to Postmarket OS as well. Under the install section, they have a list of supported devices as well. And again, a lot of these devices are quite a bit newer than what you might expect. Now, they also support doing stuff with Chromebooks as well, so the list does look quite a bit longer because of that. But the point still stands. When you are not writing all your own drivers, doing all your own stuff, you can get away with quite a bit more. Now, the problem with that is because it's coming from the Android kernel, it's not necessarily all gonna be, you know, free software compatible, because if it's coming from Android, there was never the expectation that you would use it in anything else. And because of that, I can't imagine that what they would be doing here with the Librephone would be relying on Halium. That just wouldn't make any sense. There would be way too much non-free software being loaded to fit within an FSF project. For a second, let's just assume they were using Halium. There are devices being sold that are running Halium in the background. I've talked about the Theory Labs device on the channel before, like I've it sitting on my shelf over there. This is a Halium-powered device. Not a bad thing, but the problem is, when you want to do a free software phone, there are extreme limitations in what you can do. You can either take the approach with PinePhone, with Librem, with actually making a true free software phone and be extremely limited in the hardware you can actually use, or you can compromise and take a phone that already exists and then, you know, put Linux on it like that. And this is the much more approachable way with devices that are reasonably fast and reasonably cheap. Still more expensive because it is a low sale device, but even so, a device that's a lot more viable and a lot more approachable for most people. Now, originally this part of the video was going to go differently. And then it turns out that a blog post was released. FSF announces the Librephone project. After 40 years of advocacy for computing freedom, the FSF will now work to bring the right to study, change, share, and modify the programs users depend on in their daily lives to mobile phones. This right here is basically just saying the FSF exists, we do things, phones. Phones exist, and we're gonna do phone things. Practically, the Librephone aims to close the last gaps between existing distributions of the Android operating system and software freedom. The FSF has hired experienced developer Rob Savoy to lead the technical project. He is currently investigating the state of device firmware and binary blobs in other mobile phone freedom projects, prioritizing free software work done by the not entirely free software mobile phone operating system, Lineage OS. The initial work is funded by a donation from FSF board member John Gilmore, who explained, "I've enjoyed using a mobile phone running Lineage OS with Micro G and F-Droid for years, which eliminates the spyware and control that Google embeds in standard Android phones. I later discovered the Lineage OS distribution links in significant proprietary binary modules copied from the firmware of particular phones. Rather than accept this sad situation, I looked for collaborators to reverse engineer and replace those proprietary modules with fully free software for at least one modern phone, triaging existing packages and device compatibility to find a phone with the fewest, most fixable freedom problems is the first step. From there, the FSF and Savoy aim to reverse engineer and replace the remaining non-free software. Librephone will serve existing developers and projects who aim to build a fully functioning and free, as in freedom, Android-compatible OS. The FSF has been supporting earlier free software mobile phone projects such as Replicant, and excited to launch this new effort. Gilmore added, "We were lucky to find Rob Savoy, a great engineer with decades of experience in free software, embedded systems, and project management." This is basically an Android ROM. So instead of going the route of doing Halium, instead of going the route of doing an actual phone, do Replicant. And because this one's a free software project, the kinds of devices that are supported are, you know, they're still phones. And if we're talking about getting phones into the hands of people who do not have a phone, who cannot afford a phone, this would achieve that goal. When asked to comment on the project, Savoy said, "As a long-time embedded systems engineer who has worked on mobile phones for decades, I'm looking forward to this opportunity to work towards a freedom-supporting phone and help users gain control over their phone hardware." He added, "Making fully free software for a modern commercial phone will not be quick, easy, or cheap. But our project benefits from standing on the shoulders of giants who've done most of the work. Please join us with your efforts and or with your donations." With it being the FSF, I expect a real product to be created sometime between now and the release of GNU Herd. Probably towards the GNU Herd side. But what do you think? Do you think we're ever going to hear about this Librephone ever again? Or it was just announced and that's going to be the end of it? I'd love to know. If you want to know, I'd like to know. So let me know your thoughts down below and go subscribe. And if you like the video, go like the video. And if you really like the video and you want to become one of these amazing people over here, check out the Patreon, subscribe, Stanley Barapay, linked in the description down below. That's going to be it for me, and I guess we'll have to wait and see. What is this?